Return home and tell how much God has done for you. So the man went away and told all over town how much Jesus had done for him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. You would join me now in prayer. God, we pray that through the work of your Holy Spirit, you may make these words meaningful for us in this time and in this place in which we live. Lord, we pray that you might help us to clear all the distractions from our minds, that we might focus on you and your word and that which you want us to learn. God, we pray that the meditation of our hearts and the words of our mouth may be acceptable to you. Amen. Last Saturday evening, a week ago, I was in Newcastle, staying there for an annual conference. And my nephews were there as well, and it turned out quite by accident. But I ended up in my parents' living room watching the movie The Conjuring with my 16-year-old nephew, Ethan. If you have not seen that movie, it's about a home that is possessed by demons. Now, as I was watching that movie, I thought I had the simplest solution, and that was if my home was possessed by demons, I would simply leave. That would be the end of the story. End of the movie, everything's taken care of. However, they had professionals come in and told them that it wouldn't do them any good to leave their home because the demons would simply fall. Now, there were a few scary scenes. There was lots and lots of screaming in the movie. And I would admit that maybe I jumped a few times. I didn't see the end. I went to bed because really scary movies aren't my thing. I thought about all the ridiculous ways that people come up with to scare people. And some people, like Ethan and maybe some of you, are entertained by being scared. As I went to bed, what I believed about that, about demons possessing people, possessing homes. I got up early on Sunday morning for annual conference, turned on the television as I was getting ready, and I became a believer that there are demons in us. Pure evil can possess a person. Whether it be a man who enters a nightclub in Orlando, Florida and kills 49 innocent people and injures over 50 more, or a man centuries ago from the region of Gesera, also possessed by demons, unkept, wild-eyed, naked, living in a cemetery, broken chains and shackles hanging from his wrists and ankles. Jesus and his disciples climb out of their boat, and the demon-possessed man falls down in front of Jesus. And here again, I would have to confess that my answer would be to leave. I would be right back in that boat and sail somewhere else, but not Jesus and the disciples. The demons verbally assault Jesus because he ordered the demon to come out of the man. Jesus proceeds extraordinarily to carry on a conversation with the demons. He demands their name. And they tell him legion. Legion, meaning many. They then beg Jesus not to send them into the abyss, but instead to a nearby herd of pigs. And Jesus does what they ask. The demons entered the pigs. They ran down over a hill into a lake, and they drowned. The man is healed. He's restored, and returned to his family and community. Legion. We are surrounded by a legion of demons that can make this world we live in a downright frightening place. We can name some demons among us. Certainly, demons of hate. Hatred of people who think and act and look different than we are. Immediately what comes to mind are Islamic terrorists who look at Christians and the West in general with absolute hatred. And their ultimate solution is that we be eliminated. However, we as Christians are not immune from fanaticism. If you look up the word fanatic in the dictionary, it will tell you that it means someone who is insanely responding to a misunderstood view. Insanely responding to a misunderstood view. I also share with you that I was truly grieved this week to read the words of a pastor from Arizona in response to what happened in Orlando last summer. He says this in part. The Bible says that homosexuals be put to death in Leviticus 20:13. Obviously, it's not right for somebody to just, you know, shoot up the place, because that's not going through the proper chance. But these people all should have been killed anyway through the proper chance. As in, they should have been killed by a righteous government who would have tried them, convicted them, and saw them. Those are words of people. They are not in any way, shape, or form words from Christians. The fact that they were preached from a pulpit makes me not only sick, but angry. Because the Jesus that I follow would also be grieved and angry by those words. It would certainly be my hope and prayer that no one here has such hatred in their heart for any person or group of people. Power is also a demon. Both of individuals and nations, power is demonized when we seek to control and maintain without a sense of the need for justice and mercy. And we need only to look at our world to see the demons of power. Hitler, Stalin, Saddam Hussein, Osama bin Laden. We need only read the news, turn on the TV, to see what's happening in Syria. Close to 500,000 people have been killed. Over 4.5 million are refugees, half of them children. Why? Because somebody is bent on power and will do anything necessary to get it. Greed is a demon, and it makes us slaves of wanting more and more and never being satisfied with what we have. Greed makes things more important than people. Addiction is a demon. Drugs, alcohol, pornography, gambling. Demons that tear individuals and families apart. Addictions enslave people and deceive them into believing that they can't live without whatever possesses them. A legion of demons. We can certainly name more. What is the solution? Actually, the solution for us today is the same solution that the Pharisee demoniac. The solution is Jesus. Either Jesus is the answer to the ultimate problems of the human condition, or there is no ultimate answer. And you see, that involves us. When I read those words of hatred just a couple of minutes ago, does it help you to understand better why people want nothing to do with the church? We must live out our discipleship if there is any hope for exorcising the demons of this world. And how do we do that? I thought through that this week and came up with a few suggestions. The first would be to live with a heart that does not become desensitized to human suffering. With the technology we have today, we see so much suffering. People who are victims of violence, people who are starving to death, people who are victims of natural disasters. We see so much of it, we just get used to it. And we truly don't grieve the suffering of other people. May we see it for our lives. May we pray for those people and not become uncaring. I also think we need to understand and help other people understand that all people are created by God, that they're loved by God just as much as you and I are, and that they are valuable. The United Methodist Discipline states this: we affirm that all persons are individuals of sacred worth, created in the image of God, and that all persons need the ministry of the church. The church should not be seen as the enemy. People need to see that the church recognizes them as sacred, valuable creations of God. That we don't exclude them, we don't ostracize them with an opinion that somehow we are better than they are. In every relationship we have, whether it be with family or friends or the stranger on the street, we need to be agents of grace and forgiveness and repentance, accountability, and peace and reconciliation. And lastly, is a writing I read this week from Reverend Eric Park, who is the pastor of First United Methodist Church in Butler, a friend of mine. He says this: I strive for the saving and sanctifying grace of Jesus to occupy my journey so substantially and so transformationally that there is no room left for anything that does not bear witness to the way Jesus values, the truth he embodies, and the life he offers. No room for anything that is not in Christ. Where was God last Sunday morning as those gunshots went out? I believe that he was right in the desert. In the agony of each gunshot wound, in the anguish of every tear and cry of pain, God answered the prayers, showed mercy and grace and forgiveness. But with a breaking and bleeding heart, for all the ways that we inflict pain and suffering upon one another, because that's who God is. You see, God knows all about suffering. His Son suffered the agony of crucifixion. And why is that? Because we allow the demons to get up in him and to cause us to do things and believe things and follow ideas that are contrary to God's will for us. We watch the news, we're saddened, we're grieved, we're angered, we're frustrated, we're not sure what to think and what to do. But the solution, there is ultimately only one solution. And that is Jesus Christ. And we have been called to share the love and the gospel of Jesus Christ with everyone. It's my prayer that this church will never be seen as the end. It will be seen as a welcoming place where people can come and feel loved and accepted and know that they are loved. May that be our mission in this country. Let us pray. God, there are many demons in our world. And as we read in Scripture, we answer the solution, regardless of what the demon might be, is Jesus Christ yourself. God, help us to put him forward, to help our lives to be all about that which is of Christ. Help us to be welcoming and loving, to truly love our neighbor, as Jesus has called us to do. We pray in his name. Amen. Our last hymn is in the green hymnal, page 3105.